Let's get started. So what have we covered so far? We wanted to represent each word by a vector. So we want to come up with vector representations for words in our dictionary. And in the end, the task is something like this. The similar word, when they come to syntactic or semantic analogies, you want your word vectors to be able to deal with them. Basically put words that are semantically similar or syntactically similar close to each other. So that's the final objective for word representations, or at least one way to test whether you actually learned anything, whether your words learned any meaning. And for doing that, we were using the escapegram model. So this is the escapegram model. A word goes in and you're predicting its context. So a word goes in and you're predicting the context words. And you had three options for your loss function. Your entire loss function is going to look like this. That is the escapegram model. Now the question is, how are you going to represent the probability or the log of the probability? And we had three options to represent that. One is the softmax, which is going to be very slow, given the size of our vocabulary being in the order of 10 million and above. You can use hierarchical softmax. So these are alternatives. You can either use this or hierarchical softmax, or you can do negative sampling. And they are being sorted according to their cost. So this is the most costly. This is a little bit less costly. It's log 2 of W rather than W. And the cost of negative sampling is K. It's a hyperparameter that you choose. It could be 10. So this is the fastest. And in practice, this is actually what is being implemented in the algorithm. So for the word to vec algorithm, this is the one that is being used in practice. So any questions before I move to the next? So this is a continuation of what we just saw. So these two papers, they are going to give you word to vec. It's the algorithm that is going to convert your words to vectors. There is actually an alternative way of doing it, rather than using the escapegram model, which is I give you a word, you predict the words in the context. You could alternatively use continuous bag of words, CBAW, continuous bag of words. And it's exactly the opposite direction of the escapegram model. For the continuous bag of words, I give you the context, and the task is for you to tell me what is the word in that context. What is the target word? What is the word in the middle? And the way that it works is that you're gonna, if you think of these as one-hot vectors, you're gonna multiply that and project it, multiply that by a matrix. That's gonna be the matrix of your word embeddings. And then it's gonna get projected into a lower dimension. But then if you do that, you're gonna end up with 1, 2, 3, 4 vectors. But in the end, you need only one vector. So you just add them up. You just add those vectors together. They have the same dimension, you can add them. So you're adding 4 vectors, and that's going to give you the vector. After the projection, you're going to do another matrix vector multiplication to go back to the original one-hot vector dimension. Basically, this is going to be the size of your vocabulary. And that's your continuous bag of words. Why do we call it bag of words? Because you're just summing them up. You're putting everything in one bag. You just sum them up. That's why it's a bag of words. And the rest of it is you just write down your log of the probabilities and then you maximize it. It's very similar to before. And we are interested in tasks like this. This is a syntactic task. What is the relationship between small and smallest given biggest and big? So there is a question. So just to make sure I understand, in continuous bag of words, we take the context words and predict the probability of seeing a single word. But in the escapegram model, we take a single word and predict the probability of seeing the context words. Exactly. So you're putting it exactly correctly. The task that we saw in the previous slide was a semantic task. This is a syntactic task. The relationship biggest to big is similar to small to what? And then you're going to be able to answer questions like this. It's going to be the smallest. Okay. And these are syntactically correct. And what is this distance? The distance that we're going to use is the cosine similarity distance. So this is the cosine similarity distance. So there is a question, what's the benefit of using continuous bag of words over escapegram? We are going to see, we can answer those sorts of questions empirically, and we're going to see when they have advantage over each other. I'm going to go through that shortly. There is another, this is semantic. It means that your algorithm is getting the meaning of the words. Berlin to Germany is equal to France to what? And then it's going to give you Paris. And this is cool. Whenever you have vectors for your words, you can do addition, you can do subtraction, you can compute the distance. That's why it is important to for your computers to see words as vectors. And then they're going to be able to work with them. So what type of other examples do we have for semantic and syntactic? So these are semantic. Athens to Greece is similar to Oslo to Norway. So you're going to create a data set like this. And then you're going to that data set, this is going to be your test data set, to evaluate the performance of your algorithm. How many times did it get these outcomes correctly? Norway, Zimbabwe, Real, etc. So it's going to make mistakes. It's a statistical framework. But on average, how many times was it successful in solving that problem? And the other ones are syntactic. For instance, it could be adjective to adverb, converting from adjective to adverb. Apparent to apparently is similar to rapid to rapidly, etc. Easy, easiest, lucky, luckiest. Work, works, speak, speaks. Now that we have a test data, let's evaluate the performance of continuous bag of words and a skip gram and compare it to some previous state of the art. But for us, it's more important to compare continuous bag of words to skip gram. So for semantic accuracy, the task above, these are semantic, the continuous bag of words is 24% of the time, correct? So out of 100 examples that you show it, 24 of them, it's going to give you the correct answer. And the skip gram model is giving you 55. So it turns out for solving semantic tasks, the skip gram model is doing better. But when you go to a continuous bag of words, the continuous bag of words, when you go to syntactic accuracy, the continuous bag of words is doing better than skip gram.
It seems somewhat strange to compare the two methods, given that they're sort of quite different. Like one has four inputs in this case, and the other one has only one.
And you are on the right track. You're telling me implicitly that if I give you four contexts, it's an easier task to predict the word in the middle compared to if I give you a single word, it's harder to predict the context. So yes, that's correct. And that's why the skip gram model is giving you more meaning for your words compared to syntax.
Okay.
And then overall, these two models are doing much better than RNN language model and neural network language model, the previous state of the art. And there are some other examples. For instance, France to Paris is similar to Italy to Rome, Japan to Tokyo, Florida to Tallahassee. So you give it France, Paris, Italy, and it's giving you Rome. You give it France, Paris, Japan, and it's giving you Tokyo, etc.
Is it common that in like data sets used to train these models that will give you such a table for evaluation?
Yes, for evaluating your word vectors, these are the types of methods that you're going to evaluate them. So that one, I'm going to leave it up to you. So now this is part of your exploratory data analysis.
Okay.
And then there is a question about, do people still use continuous bag of words, skip gram today, or are there better methods wandering because the paper is from 2013? No, people actually use continuous bag of words and a skip gram model even today. So we are going to cover, and there is a mention of BERT, we are going to cover language models later on. And then you're going to see what is the difference functionality, why people use a language model and why people use word vector representations. So no, people actually use word vectors even today. Okay. And no, you cannot replace it with a language model. And even for language models like BERT and GPT, the first layer is always going to turn a one-hot vector to a word vector representation that could be trained on the fly, or it could be initialized with these word vectors. Okay? So we're going to cover that. And yes, people use it, and I want you to learn it. And no, it's not outdated. Okay?
So would this sort of model be used more for maybe like like when you're typing in a search and like the predicted next words show up, as opposed to like interpreting like a block of text?
What you're explaining is more language models.
Okay.
You give it the previous words and the task is to predict the next word. And those are sequential language model. But BERT is a denoising language model. You're going to learn about it. So we are going to go into details. But no, this is these papers that I'm covering with continuous bag of words and SkipGram, they have applications all over the place. Okay, so they are very important. The loss for continuous bag of words is very similar to the loss for SkipGram. So it's going to be exactly this, but now you don't have that context. You are conditioning on multiple inputs, WT minus one, WT T minus two, T minus one, T plus one, T plus two. So you're conditioning on multiple words. So this summation goes away, and then the rest of it is you have the log of that. Okay, any other questions? So far, so good.
I do have a question, actually.
Yes.
I'm wondering if it's harder to train SkipGram because you're trying to predict four different words than CBAO because you're predicting one word.
It seems to be a harder task because you have only one input and you're predicting the four words, four context. It seems to be a harder task.
So does it take like far more time to actually train the model to reach similar accuracy?
No, I don't think so. Because in the end, what you're going to do is you're going to take pairs of words. It's going to be WT, WT minus one, WT, WT minus one, etc. Okay?
So what does a test look like for the SkipGram model for like testing the output for that?
So this is exactly what I was explaining here.
Okay.
The testing.
It's also a bag of words stuff, but yeah. Okay.
Yeah. And then it's going to have applications all over the place. You're going to see it. It's going to show up constantly. We are going to use a word embedding. We are going to use a word embedding. We are going to use a word embedding. It's going to be the first sentence in every single paper that you read. Okay? It's fundamental.